our merciful Heavenly Father, in times like these, we need you more than ever. We appreciate so much, dear Lord, that you gave us a gift of life. We appreciate so much, dear Lord, that you gave us your Bible and revealed to us your revelation for where we used to be, and where we are right now, and where we are going to. Even during this time of trouble, dear Lord, you are teaching and forming our characters. Today, as we will study your word, as we will sing songs, as we will praise you, help us to do it honestly. And we appreciate so much your holy presence here. Bless all the individuals, bless all the guests, and bless all the visitors, and especially bless those who are watching us online today. Let your name go with praise. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Our scripture reading for this morning is taken from the book of Judges, chapter 16, verse 20 to 22. And she said, "The Philistine upon his Samson." So he awoke from his sleep and said, "I will go out as before at other times and shake myself free." And he did not know that the Lord had departed from him. Then the Philistines took him and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gaza. They bound him with bronze fetters, and he became a grinder in the prison. However, the hair of his head began to grow again after it had been shaken. May the Lord add his blessing to his word.
Racing, racing, 249, 249. I'll be leading for those who are at home watching, and for those who are here, please sing with me to yourself.
All of your heart. So if we have needs today, let's give it to the Lord in prayer. Kahului, Kahului.
Time, Lord, the enemy is working hard and overtime to steal their joy, to steal their relationship with your parents, to steal their relationship, Father God, with you. And I pray, Lord God, that you have mercy upon our children. I pray, Father God, that you protect them, Lord. Build a hedge around them, Father God, and bring them to you, Lord. Father, as the parents, we kneel and we pray. But we know that Jesus is praying for our children, even to us as the parents, and to myself as praying up to you. Father, we thank you for the prayer of Jesus Christ, that he once prayed for Peter, and Peter was redeemed. And Lord, we all needed the prayer of Jesus within our life. Cause us, Father God, to love one another and to love you supremely in everything. Father, I pray that the rest of our service, may you become our experience. May the Holy Spirit will be our joy. May this congregation, Father God, will be coming and fellowship with you. And may your presence will never depart from us. We want to say one more time, Father, not only in our heart, but to confess publicly and within among ourselves this morning, Father, that we do love you. And we do love you so much. We can only do that through helping with the Holy Spirit. And help us, Father God, to live likewise. And we give you all the praises, thanksgiving, and the honor. And we ask all of these things. In Jesus' worthy name we pray. Amen.
Worship God through giving. Of course, we're not collecting an offering, but we have the slot outside as you walk out, and also online. You can give online. Now, I've been wondering, you know, every so often, why is God allowing this to go on and on, you know, with the pandemic? But it's probably, you know, most likely it's for us. Test. Because it's a test whether you're going to come to church, whether you're going to focus on Jesus, are you going to be scared of your house, or you know, are you going to continue to give even though you don't know where your next paycheck is coming from?
I'd like to share with you a text. I mean, it's a little favorite. Malachi 3, verse 10 says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. So test the Lord. Try giving the tithes and offerings faithfully, even though we're all in a bit of a bind here. See what the Lord does for you. Also, in most of our budget, actually more than half of our budget is to our little schools here. The preschool we just opened up in our MAS or HMA Maui now it's called, as well as HMA in Oahu, the academy. And we've actually been very blessed with our school this year because there's 19 students. So, you know, please remember that in your offering because that's what supports our worthy student fund and our stipend that we pay to the Congress of Trust Support our teachers. And the kids are very blessed. I heard a very good report. So we pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this promise that you would bless us as we bless others as we give. And we know, Lord, that this is true because I know we all experience this blessing. Maybe if it's not even in the monetary bracket, it's always a good feeling, a good Please bless everyone who has decided in their heart to give, to look beyond what's happening around them, and be generous, and show their love to others and to you through their tithes and offerings. Please take it, multiply it, and do it, do your will with our tithes and offerings. We thank you and praise you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name.
taking our lines to the lantern for our worship service right now, and I would like to greet all of you who are here today. It's so nice to see you face to face. It's so good to be here at the house of worship, in the house of prayer. Yes, I would like to also extend our warm welcome to all our friends for watching us online on this beautiful Sabbath morning. I had a privilege to visit actually Molokai Island last weekend, and had a privilege to see brothers and sisters in Christ, and we had a wonderful time when we had Sabbath school lesson together and worship service, and after that we actually admired the whole entire facility, which is huge, and they have a school place and they have classes over there. Unfortunately, it's all empty. And there is no students, and school is not in operation. And we need to pray. This is what they asked me, to pray for them, and God for them to reopen the school again, and to praise the name of Jesus with our children. All these young ladies and young men send us greetings from our Church, and wanted for us to enjoy life in Jesus' presence. Let us pray as we go into the service. Merciful Heavenly Father, we are praising you for the gift of wisdom. We are praising you with your will to change our lives. Today, as we will go into the Bible study and talk about Samson and his life, use, dear Lord, this as an illustration for us to change us and to make us not just a better individuals, but to belong completely to you. Help us surrender our lives to you and be guided and moved by your Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, amen. The title of today's message, What God Can Do To You For Ordinary You, we will look at the Samson's life. Actually, it's interesting what all people are admiring strong people. We are all admiring strong people. And strong people are actually always seems to be like they have it all together. And it seems like they are quite strong. And they don't crumble in a time of crisis. And when the Bible is hitting them, they are not afraid because they know that God is in control, everything is controllable, so it should not fall under the pressure of depression or complete fear. And they don't afraid of anything that is happening around them. Instead, they then have the situation in their heart that's holding them. They're quite calm and full of peace from Jesus. They are always God's creation under control. And everybody wants to be a strong person. I would like to invite all of you to open your Bibles today in the book of Judges. Besides, we are going to use your insert. How many of you receive inserts in your bulletins? All of you. Okay, if you don't have a pen, raise your hand. Our deacons and our elders will help you to receive a pen. And in order for us to write right now in our inserts, in order for you to remember the sermon, and you have an outline. Actually, we see what in the book of Judges, we have an example of life of Samson. And as you will open your Bibles, the book of Judges, you will find out that Samson was a very strong man who ever lived on the planet Earth. Samson was a very strong man who ever lived on the planet Earth. But spiritually, he had a hard time to lift the balloon. He had no strength at all, spiritually. But it's interesting what Samson mentioned in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. In God's gathering of the year, in God's wall of fame, all the famous people in the Hebrews chapter 11, and Samson's name is over there. It's kind of always impressive for me to see what he is here. But it's interesting to begin for all of us right from the book of Judges, chapter 13. This is where it starts. The woman gave birth to a boy and named him Samson, and he grew. And the Lord did what? Yes, Samson. He had everything right from the beginning. He was very blessed right from the beginning of his life. He had a good look, he had a spiritual strength. And Samson was raised in a godly home. And actually, he was dedicated as a little baby. And as a young man, he took the Nazarite of vow, which is the vow of complete dedication to the Lord. But it happened to be in his life where he lost it all. Why? What really happened? happened in Samson's life. It's interesting what Sister White is saying about Samson. In the magazine of the Signs of the Times in 1881, Samson failed where Joseph overcome. And actually, Samson, in his peril, had the same source of strength as had Joseph. He could choose the right or wrong as he pleased. But instead of taking hold of the strength of God, he permitted the wild passions of his nature to have full way. Samson. When he became a teenager, he rebelled. He didn't listen to his parents. And I would like for you to open your inserts right now. And I would like to look at the insert. What is the cause of that problem over here? When what we can learn from the life of Samson, what we can avoid. You see, it says over here, right from the beginning, the first step, self-indulgence weakens your life. The absence of self-control, anything what is left uncontrolled in your life will weaken you. Now take a pen and write it down. Self-indulgence weakens you. You see, it could be anything. When maybe you spend just money in your life. It could be sex. It could be food. It could be alcohol. It could be your emotions. It could be how you manage your time. Anything what left out of control is really weakens your life. In chapter 14, we have this special encounter to see the character of Samson. It says, chapter 14, 1 through 3, actually, how now Samson went down to Timon and saw a woman in Timon, the daughter of Philistine. So he went up and home. He told his father and mother, saying, I have seen a woman in Timon of the daughters of Philistine, and therefore get her for me as a wife. Then his father and mother said to him, is there no woman among the daughters of brothers of your brother from among your own people? But you must go and get a wife from the uncircumcised Philistines. Son, can you hear us? She is not believing in our God the same way as we believe. Do you understand where you're going into? And Samson said to his father, and this is his word, get her from me. She pleases me. Well, it means Samson is saying, in other words, she makes me laugh. She makes me happy. I'm enjoying her. And you American Standard Bible actually saying, get her from me. She looks good. It's interesting how the young people are choosing their partner for the life just by making you fun, by making looks good, and so on. Fun and beauty. But then Samson actually lived a life of self-indulgence. And just look at what's happening here. All he considered was his own pleasures. The parents' advice didn't matter. No, just go and get her for me. She pleases me. And our classic excuse over here of self-indulgence in this attitude, just maybe this one time, no one will know it. It will be just a little bit. It could not hurt anyone, it's just this one time. Satan's favorite temptation is just telling you, oh, it's just a small thing, no one even will know it, and he will just pay attention to this and just make you smile and give you a good compliment. And after that, they will see what is going to happen after. But in reality, small little things can ruin your whole entire life. And I would like to use an illustration here. Let's say you are going to take a cruise to the Caribbean islands. And the pandemic is over, everything is out of mass right now, they're enjoying life, they're back at the cruise, and they're going to the Caribbean islands. And maybe you decide to go to the island of Curacao. And as you're traveling there, you go ready to up from the shore, and maybe you're on a big oasis on the sea, is that particular line. Huge! The boat pulls out from the shore, and you're so excited, you get in Curacao. And then the captain happens to mention, for everybody on the boat, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't want to upset you. I waited until you were off the shore. But this boat has a little leak. Don't worry, it's just a little leak. Everything will be fine. We will continue on our cruise and our journey. Everything will be just well. If you are smart enough, you will probably say, would you mind dropping me back at the shore again, please? As soon as possible. You see, the only question is here, the only how much time is going to get for this huge big ship to sink down because of this small little leak. How do I handle the little things in my life? And this is what the Bible actually is teaching us to do according to Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. It says, don't be misled or deceived. Some other translations say, remember what you can't ignore, whom? God. And get away with it. And man will always reap just the kind of crop he sowed. This is quite serious, my dear brothers and sisters. You see, this is what you need to write down right now in your insert. The lesson of Samson's life, the first lesson. Strong people discipline their desires. Strong people discipline their desires because they just don't say, oh, it's only a little thing. Everything will be fine. No, strong people discipline their desires. According to the book of Proverbs, chapter 25, it says, a person without self-control is like a city with a broken down wall. The Bible is teaching you, if you have a little need in your life, if you have undiscipline in your life, if you act in a way like you don't care, you are defenseless, you are like a city without walls. And this is illustration is staying by a throne. Second point here in life, bitterness will weaken your life. Bitterness. And here's an illustration from the life of Samson. You see how he lived in a constant state of resentment and anger. Even though he was blessed in the childhood, but he disobeyed his parents, went astray to their foreign country, and now acted in a strange way as a rebel teenager, and he's saying, I'm upset. What is really happening? Look at these words over here. Judges chapter 15, verse 7 says, Samson said to them, since you acted like this, I swear that I won't stop until I get revenge by you. Oh, this is strong words. You see, you're using your time, your energy, using your creativity, using all this in a special way by wasting it because you are full of anger. And this is what the Bible is teaching you and me. If you just waste your time to get even, the problem with this, you see, what you are worried, you are upset on another individual. And that person you are upset for is over, maybe totally oblivious. He has no idea what you are upset for. And you are worried in your heart. You are depressed. You are stressed out. You have that resentment and anger toward that person. But that person is enjoying life. You don't care at all. You see, and you're just wasting your time. And you're wasting your energy. Because you're getting upset and emotionally disturbed. And you find out under the stress and pressure and fatigue. And you're losing your energy without knowing what that individual is just finding life. And he is enjoying life. And he's don't care. When you look at the life of Samson, you see what he's using quite a special creativity option to share his revenge. In Judges chapter 15, actually, it says in verse 3, then Samson said to them, this time I have a right to get even with their Philistines. I will really, what should he want to do? Harm them. So he went out and caught how many? 300 folks and tied them tail to tail in pairs. It's amazing. The foxes now. So strange. Then he passed the torch to every pair of tails. They were suffering. They were struggling. He lit the torches and let the foxes loose, staying in the grain on the Philistines. He put them in the crops, the corn and wheat, and actually, and he burned up the shocks and staining grain together with the vineyard and olive groves. That's quite pretty creative anger. According to what actually Samson is doing here. Because he is actually sharing his revenge. This is what self-hypocrisy, self-indulgence, and bitterness weakens your life, actually. And this is what you need to write down right now in your outline. Strong people restrain their reactions. Strong people, they know how to control themselves. They will restrain their reactions. According to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 32, it says, modern translation here in the message, moderation is better than mastery, self-control better than political power. When I read this, I said, I need to share it with all the church members, with all of you, dear brothers, because moderation, it means when you have a humbleness in your heart, when you have the Spirit of God in you, you will have self-control in your life. But bitterness weakens your life. Self-indulgence weakens your life. And now there is a third point. Carelessness weakens your life. When you look at the life of Samson, he was a very careless person. His strength was a gift from the Lord. It was not his gift. He didn't achieve it by working so hard. He received this as a gift from the Lord. He was a miracle baby. From his childhood, he was quite special. And now we see, according to the Judges chapter 13, in God's word, it says, the messenger of the Lord appeared to Job, his mother, and said, you never been able to have a child, but now you will become pregnant, and you will have a son. And now, just you should be careful, because he's not going to be just a regular child. As a Nazarene, he is going to be, as a Nazarite, he is going to be actually special with his power and ability to save his own people, although you really need to treat yourself very carefully during the pregnancy time. Don't drink any vile liquor or eat any unclean food. You are going to become pregnant and have a son, and you must never cut his hair, because the boy will be a Nazarite dedicated to God from his birth. This is amazing what we have here in the life of Samson. The problem with Samson's life, he totally forgot his vows. He forgot God's 10 commandments. And Samson assumed everything was just a big game. And he enjoyed his game and he had a good time in life. At the same time, Samson had a weakness for women. Three different women in three different chapters, as we read it from the beginning, the life of Samson. Delilah tried to find out the secret of his strength. And Samson, he just teased her. She tried four different times. After leaving Gaza, it says in the Bible, he fell in love with a woman in a story of the name of Delilah. And actually, the Philistine rulers came to him and said, treat him and find out what makes him what? So strong. Find out how we can overpower him. We want to tie him up in order to torture him. Each of us will give you how much? 1,100 pieces of silver. It's a huge amount, and all of those commanders are willing to give such an amount to get Samson. Here is it, a huge price on his head. And now, so Delilah is actually said to Samson, please help me. What makes you so strong? So simple, but so generic. But Samson is going to play the game with him. If someone just ties me up. So she put him to bed, and some men were hiding in their bedroom over there waiting for her to tie him up. This is amazing how the Bible explains all the details. And this is what's happening over here. And after that, she's crying out, Samson, Samson, the Philistines are over here. And Samson is happy to jump out of the bed and no one could find out why he was so strong. Because he was still in full power. But look, you're making fun of me, but telling me lies. She tried four different times. You think Samson will start catching it up? Samson, what is going on? But for us men, sometimes we have no idea what's happening. Because our ego, it's not working anymore. What is really going on? She already tried four attempts and you don't get it. Samson, what's happening to you? And now he's still playing his games. And we see, according to Judges chapter 16, verse 13, it says, if you were, if you weigh my seven loves of the year in your womb, and make it tight as a peg, I'll be weak as anybody else. Look what's happening over here. This verse is telling you and me what he kept studying, accepting, compromising, little by little. That little leak in his huge ship, in his huge boat, is really started right from here. But maybe not exactly from here, but from his actual lifestyle. Because he actually allowed the medical view to get so close to his actual truth, to his hair. And after that, the Bible says, so she said to him, how can you say you love me according to the God's word translation? How can you say you love me when you don't mean it? You have made me a fool me 3 times already, and you still haven't told me what makes you so strong. Can you imagine what's happening at home? I'm trying to place myself in that situation and say, wow, maybe she was crying. Samson, wow, no, and excuse me, and Samson was already saying, come on. She kept on asking him day after day, day after day. But someone said, a man is never weaker than a woman is telling him how strong he is. This is very true in life. You see, and she kept asking him day after day. He got so sick and tired of her bothering him about it, and finally told her the truth. My hair has never been caught. And that was it. The problem in Samson's life was he was compromising little by little by little. His lifestyle had been weakening him for years. The haircut episode was simply a final stone. It was not just happened once overnight. The Bible is telling us that every affair, everything that's happening in life, it's not happening immediately. It usually takes time. You see, his entire lifestyle was robbing him of every strength that God has given unto him. Judges is telling us, having put him to sleep under the love, she called a man to shave off the seven. This is what's happening here. And he's here. So began to subdue him, and so his strength left him. Then she called, Samson, Samson, the dark seems up on you. And Samson is thinking, what else is you? I already did this so many times. He awoke from his sleep, and there, I'll go out of the room and shake myself clean. But he did not know what the Lord was about. My dear beloved, this is one of the most tragic statements in the Bible in the whole of my story. He did not know what the Lord was about. Check your life. I'm checking one. Because of our lifestyle, maybe we can easily not even notice what we have a little leak in our huge, big, old life. You see, the lesson is, nobody ever plans to be a neighbor. Nobody. It comes so just gradually, naturally, little by little. Nobody ever says, I'm going to plan to be an alcoholic in the future. No one is planning to do so. It comes little by little. Or nobody says, I'm going to be a drug addict. It's coming little by little in your actual life. And somebody actually said, I never intended to destroy my own marriage. Yes, but it starts with a little look, or a little word, little compliment, and until it turns into an affair. It all starts very little with the smallest. What's the lesson we are learning from Samson's life? Write it down. Strong people keep their commandments. They keep their commitments. Strong people keep their commitments. They guard them. They're not careless. They're very serious about their relationship to the Lord. They know what 10 commandments which the Lord actually proposed to them. They're standing strong, written by God himself with his own finger.
on the stones, and they bring them freedom, and they're protecting them from the evil one. Ten commandments are standing strong. What actually, a sin check in your life, what is actually the weak link in your life? What is the one area that's quite weak in your life? You see, the chain is not any stronger than the weak link in your life. Look at the tragic results. The biggest saints grab. They grab Samson. They immediately poked out his eyes and took him to the prison in Gaza. The whole story actually begins from Gaza, as Samson went to the Philistines. And now he's going back to Gaza. They tied him up with double chain and made him bring grains in the new field. What happened to Samson? The champion of Israel became a clown. Someone just to make fun. He had everything, but what's happened? He lost it. Did it happen overnight? No. The good news, but the Bible is still giving you and me the second chance. And this is where I'm really excited to share with you what his hair started to grow back as soon as he was shaved off. Samson came and prayed now. Yes, he was blind. He crashed in his life, but he started to think about God. And he prayed fervently right now, and he confessed his sins. And Samson's great victory was on the last day of his life. What God could do for ordinary you? I just wonder. What God could do for you and me? There is something comforting about the life of Samson. Samson is mentioned in Hebrews 11. This is the wall of fame. You will expect people like Abraham and Moses and Jabez and others over there, but there is this fellow who was an absolute failure from the teenage years. And actually, in his life, he completely ran away from the Lord. And he lost it all. But now the Lord is bringing him back and putting his name on a wall of fame. I want to say, even the Hebrew 11 is amazing. Why do you allow for him to be here? Because he confessed his sins, he repented. And this is the comforting for me personally. Comforting because I can see whatever failure you have in your life, whatever mess you need in your life, the Lord is willing to accept you back. Maybe you had moral failure. The Lord is asking and asking you, please come back, there is a second chance for you. Maybe you have a financial failure. The Lord is saying, I will help you come back to me. Maybe you have a relationship problem. Maybe you have some problems in your family. The God is saying, there is a good news for you. Come back to me. How could God ever use me, maybe you wonder. In the last days of his life, Samson actually reacted differently. He was not worrying anymore about his personal life on this earth. God is not asking you and me to edit out our lives. He's asking us to be involved under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in the real life to help the people around us and to be a benefit to our own family and even to use our life with praise the Lord Jesus. Because Samson actually, even though, you see, he did so poorly in his life, but he is there in the wall of fame in Hebrews 11 with David, with the King David, with Joseph, who was the faithful one, and with all those other people as well. It's amazing what God could use Samson, that he could use you, and he could use me. You see, it's a commitment. It's a recommitment. It means it's baptism. It means it's Bible study. It means it's your faith when you share your faith with the others. And you will see what God could do for ordinary. I believe what God brought you here for a special reason. I believe God has a purpose for you. I don't know how this story from the Bible relates to your life personally, but I can guarantee, I guarantee you there are some areas of your life that you can find some correlation. You know it all. Maybe it's in the area you haven't, I haven't even mentioned here from the Bible. But you know the area of your life where you have that leak in your life. The biggest leak. You see, God is saying to you, plug the hole in the boat before your big ship is going to sink. There is still time for them to believe now. It is wise to learn from the experience of the others. Look at the life of Samson. He just prayed, dear God, please change me. And God did. God will change your mind and mine if you will still reconsider and start praying to the Lord. You will pray and say, please remove the things out of my life and make me a better person, not a bigger person. Lord, help me to discipline my desires. Help me to control them. Oh yes, the Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to recommit my life and maybe I want to make that easy for your glory. I want maybe to be re-baptized again for your glory because you're amazing God and for this pandemic experience, for this virus situation, you're holding me accountable, but you pay attention personally to me and you would like to give me a second chance and a third chance and save my life. May the Lord richly bless you, because as long as you will start to pray, you will see what God will do to ordinary.
Shall we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you are a God of love that gives second chances like you did for Samson, that you can give us, that you gave us another chance through Jesus Christ, that we can be forgiven for our shortcomings and that we can be live a life that's dedicated to you. Please guide us, especially in this time of trouble that we're going through, that we will remain faithful to you and you only, Lord. We thank you and we praise you.